Okay, so sorry, I ran out of batteries on that last one. So, yeah, so I was saying if you get this cross, deform it in the two different directions and bolt it on, you get a really nice flexure coupling that has pretty low mass that can very stiffly pass this through, and only in part that I can get motions and all, accommodate misalignments in all other directions, have degrees of freedom, all others. But be careful because there is actually mass here, and this will be under constraint to translate and tip and tilt. And so you could cut a hole in there or something to reduce the mass as much as possible of the actual element. But it'll do a nice job. Okay, so these are other examples. These two, all three of these get this interesting constraint space. And obviously, as an order of constraint of two. Okay, this is like a hollow cylinder with a, basically, if you extrude that the sides of that V blade flexure out of it, you get something interesting. Okay, here's order of constraint of three. These are basically synonymous with a blade flexure. And it's actually not no surprise. You just get a blade flexure and cut things out, the circles, and you get kind of the same thing. And this, you just cut diamonds out, and you get a blade flexure freedom space. So basically, any plane you get, if you cut it out, as long as you're not bad at cutting out, as long as you all the pieces are kind of thicker than a wire, with the exception of these little hinges here. You're going to get the same constraint space. Okay, this one's interesting. This one gets a single red rotation line, right? These are on opposing planes and stuff. This one lies on a plane that's perpendicular to that plane, so it's no surprise it would get a rotation. But that's an order of constraint of five. Okay, here is a design. Remember, I said the Holy Grail is to get just three, X, Y, Z translations with no rotations, no screws. Well, any flexure system or element that, whether it's parallel, serial, or hybrid, if they, well, you can't do it with parallel, right? But if any system that just achieves, excuse me, a single pure moment, is what you'd want to use. You'd want to use three of them, because remember the freedom space of this, and we'll go through this example in just a second, I believe. But the freedom space of this would be a sphere of translations, and its constraint space is a sphere of pure moments. So you need three. So if you take any of these, you could take, in this example, we took two, three of these. We could have also taken three of those, interestingly enough, and you would get. You would get something that achieves just the three translations. And you can see this is easy to make. It's planar. You could bolt it together. It looks nice and axisymmetric. Now, the truth is, though, here's the first three mode shapes. But the truth is because these have a lot of other mass and they're so under constrained in their, like if you add mass at their nodes, the rigid bodies, it would be horrifically under constrained. And as a consequence, when you shrink them down, even, they're still there, they're just tiny. They'll still manifest, and this will have some bad mode shapes in it, that isn't great. But it will not, if you're quasi-statically trying to achieve this, it will at least drive it over fairly nice ranges and just do X, Y, and Z. Okay, so now we're going to talk about interconnected systems and elements as far as I'm going to go with this anyway. Okay, interconnected systems. So far you can synthesize, here, this is a hybrid system. This is obviously, that's a parallel module, that's a parallel module. And so this is a serial limb, a serial system limb. Here's a serial system limb in parallel, right? And so that's what you've been doing so far. You've been doing limbs that are either parallel, hybrid, or, sorry, parallel, serial, or hybrid in parallel. But now what if you interconnect the intermediate bodies within limbs, okay? Or if you interconnect the points, lines, and curves within, elements that are serial or hybrid. Now you've got a big problem, because now you've got a loop that can go through the geometry and not pass through ground. And you can no longer model this as parallel and serial subsystems. So this whole course is based on analyzing, identifying parallel and serial things, and knowing how to deal with freedom constraint spaces in parallel and series. And same thing with the stiffness matrices, you know, how to add them, you know, in parallel, or how to add their compliance in series. But once you suddenly throw an interconnected thing, you know, and add these loops, suddenly you can't break this into an equivalent spring. You can't use the stiffness matrices in the same way, and you can't use your freedom constraint spaces in the same way. And so all the theory, well, it doesn't go out the window, but you have to integrate graph theory with it. So graph theory is a theory that tells you how you connect, how things are connected together. And you can use clever matrices in conjunction with these joints, you know, these elements of freedom constraint spaces to find the freedom constraint spaces of all the bodies. And there's a paper on that on my website, you know, and you can look it up under publications. It's called Interconnected Hybrid Systems, something. But the keywords are interconnected hybrid systems. And you can see the math is very elegant, beautiful, and simple, actually. But it's just beyond the scope of this course. I'm going to teach it in a follow-on course to this. And it's analogous with the way I was able to use stiffness matrices to make these things that I gave you in that other paper I pointed to in lecture 3. So remember, I can make the stiffness matrix of this or any interconnected system, and I can make the mass matrix of this in any interconnected system. Obviously, that one's not hard. And we can analyze the freedom and constraint space of these things, the interconnected systems. It's just beyond the scope of this course, okay? You just need to understand when it's now interconnected. So this is an example that's pretty heavily interconnected. This is a famous one. I've shown it before, where you can just get two translations. Okay, this is a system that achieves. This is called a slave master kind of system that corrects for under constraint. So you can imagine if we got rid of this whole body, if these flexures weren't here, and you just had this. You know, here's the ground, here's an intermediate stage, and here's the system. You could imagine this would translate, you know, remember, we're forgetting all this. And this would, if this was ground now, this would translate. So we've got a redundant degree of freedom, which means this system would be under constraint. So if you hold this fixed with respect to that, this guy would move, okay, under constraint. Well, the question is, can we fix that under constraint? Well, and the other thing, by the way, is even though this guy could move twice as far as that, you'll only get rid of the parasitic air. Remember, if you don't have this and you push this without all this, this guy will actually arc. And if you ground this and you push this, this guy will actually arc. But if you can push this one, if you can push this two to every one of these, then you can get rid of that parasitic air arcing, and these guys will move in sync. And I'm going to talk about this later in the next lecture about transmissions and these kind of things. But so we'll revisit this if this is confusing you. But the whole point is, we add this other arm here with these flexures to get rid of the under constraint and force this ratio to be 2-to-1 of translation, so there's no under constraint there. And you can see, if it rotates, you know, here's a ground, if it rotates around here, because this length is half the length of this, this is always forced to move twice the distance of this one and in the same direction. So, and if you lock this with respect to this, all the other ones are all locked up. So you've gotten rid of under constraint. And when these guys move, this moves 2-to-1, so it cancels the parasitic error and it fixes things. So this is kind of the reason we added this ugly arm is to fix the under constraint. And to fix the 2-to-1 kind of thing. I show this to you, so this is, you know, a common solution for this, although it's not a good one. I'll show you a much better one in the next lecture. But the point is, this is interconnected hybrid. Right, so if you clump, if you try and draw a diagram of this where you clump all the G's in the ground, and you label the stage, this S is here, then you can see how this would be connected. And maybe even a cleaner way to show it would be have the stage go all the way over, shrink this I, and have this spring going up to the stage. Now you'd see it more clearly as an interconnected hybrid. But you can kind of see how that would work. This eye, by the way, corresponds to this. These two things correspond to that. And these things correspond to those two things. Okay, and then these guys obviously correspond to that. Those two guys correspond to that, right? So, but you can see how that would be interconnected hybrid. Okay, so so here is, there's also interconnected hybrid elements, right, where you get rid of all the intermediate rigid bodies. This is obviously a heavily interconnected element. Okay, there's no intermediate bodies in between there, but they're just points. In this case, if they were extruded, it'd be lines, you know, and there's no curves. But then this is another interesting interconnected hybrid things. These are kind of like half sphere things, popped like eggshell kind of things. This is an interconnected hybrid element as well. Okay, so that's interconnected systems and elements, okay? And again, they're outside the scope of this course. I'll teach it in a bit. The solutions are really elegant. And by the way, most metamaterials are heavily interconnected. If you see these periodic lattices of compliant mechanisms stuck together that make a material, they're massively interconnected and need the interconnected theory to design. So this is starting to look like a latticed metamaterial, a 2D one anyway. There's very complex 3D ones. So you need that theory. That's how I got into interconnected hybrid, because my career started in designing precision flexure systems, which are pretty much never interconnected hybrid. But I started needing to use this fact theory to design architected materials, metamaterials, and they're massively interconnected. So I needed to learn how to do this. And it exists, and it's going to be taught in a class that I teach about architected materials. No surprise. Okay, all right. So let's do some practice here to really fortify these principles. Okay, we've already kind of done some of these examples. So remember, say you want the Holy Grail three degrees of freedom. Three translations that are orthogonal with no rotations. The freedom space is a sphere of translations. The constraint space is a sphere of moments. You'd want to break those into limb constraint spaces, since this is a space that contains three independent things. You take three independent moments pointing in axisymmetric directions. Take a serial element that achieves those, and it could be many. I gave you a big library of them, or you could synthesize them yourself. You could transform it into a hybrid. This is a serial element, but this is a hybrid, an interconnected hybrid element, actually, because we've poked holes in it to make it better and stiffened it with the tab. Okay, and then but it still has the same constraint space, and you stick it in an axisymmetric way, and you get your three translations as you've seen before. Okay, let's do another example. This one, say we want to design a hybrid system that achieves three orthogonal translations but also gets a rotation up the z-axis. Okay, so that's 4 degrees of freedom. Well, the first step, find the freedom space. It's the box of red rotation lines with not a disk, but a sphere of translations and a box of screws. Okay, not to be confused with the freedom space. There's a box of red lines and a disk of translations with no screws. Okay, this one has 4 degrees of freedom. Its constraint space is a disk of pure moments. Okay, that are perpendicular to the translations, or sorry, the rotations and screws. And for this one, if we're picking limb constraint spaces, and you don't want the limbs to over constrain it, you just pick two of them. Probably the cleanest way to do it is to pick two orthogonal ones, but we didn't want to. We're going to try and make this axisymmetric spaced 120 degrees, and so we picked three. So already, we've chosen to over-constrain our result by one. So we pick one here, one here, one here, spaced, 120 degrees apart. And then you pick a design that just achieves those moments, okay? And this one should look familiar, but we poked holes in this just to get rid of more mass, so there's no unwanted mode shapes, and the true negatives of under-constraint don't sneak their way in. And so by doing this, we make it kind of an interconnected. This was a serial limb. This is an interconnected hybrid limb because we poked holes in it, but it's not going to change the constraint space. And so we take that and space them with their 120-degree spacing, axisymmetric, and sure enough, and you know, those moments are all, they all have to be in the disk, right? So they literally point in these directions here, like this, like that way, and that way. And sure enough, you get our system that is over-constrained. Now, you might say, is there over-constrained in this? You can see, well, these are really over-constrained. But remember, since this is one continuous element, we don't consider elements to be over-constrained. Right? We just, they have an order of constraint, and this has an order of constraint of one, right? And so the only reason this, if I said, is this over-constrained, you'd say, yes, but it's only because of the limb. There's one extra limb. There's no over-constraint in any of the elements, because elements can't be over-constrained, right? And if I say, is this under-constrained, you'd say, no, because there's no intermediate rigid bodies, you know, and it's just, it's made of serial or actually interconnected hybrid elements. And so there's nothing to really flap around. Now, if you did the modal analysis of this, you know, you would get the 4 degrees of freedom you wanted, but then you'd start getting these guys to flap and do weird things. And some of that flapping may actually come before the 4 degrees of freedom you want. So you got to be careful. You know, fact gets you in the ballpark. Okay, so here is, I believe, the final exercise. And this is a real practical exercise that's really great and might be something that you would do in consulting. Okay, so so this is, yeah, my friend Jan van Eyck gave me, you know, this picture. This is I believe from his thesis, where he this is a the lens inside a CD optical mount. Okay, so you know, if you break apart these ancient CD players, or even, you know, DVD players, they have obviously these discs with divots and stuff in it that a laser reads the information from. And the laser is kind of steered or you know, focused by lenses here, and those lenses need to be very precisely moved because you're dealing with light and very small things. And so it's no wonder they're going to use flexures. Now, you might say, well, where is the flexure? Well, it's these four white pieces, and one's hiding back here, but you can see it's kind of broken apart. This piece is broken apart like this. You know, here's a magnet and coils and stuff, but here's the flexure, okay? Let me draw it a little clearer just so I get rid of everything else and draw kind of the flexure, okay? So it's like there's a ground, and then there's the stage, which is the optical mount. Say there's an optic on here. And then it's really just these four different geometries connecting it that can deform. You know, there's obviously a bunch of rigid bodies in there. Okay, so the first question is, well, analyze it for me. Tell me, how does this guy actually move? Can you visualize how this would move? You know, how do they want that lens to move as it's scanning the CD? Well, let's think about it. First of all, let me ask, is this a parallel, serial, or hybrid system? Okay, or element? Well, it's clearly not an element because there's a bunch of, you know, intermediate bodies in there. So I think it's pretty clear that this guy right here is a serial system, right? Because you've got a body, a hinge, a body, a hinge, a body, a big body, a hinge, a body, a hinge, and a body. So it's a bunch of you know, living hinges, which are parallel elements, stacked in series. In a way, and you can't get rid of their, you know, you can't shrink, get rid of this rigid body to a point line or curve to make an element. This is a serial system limb, right? Because you've got basically four parallel living hinges stacked in series, twisted 90 degrees from each other, making this thing up. And there's no doing away with the intermediate rigid bodies to make an element. So it's a system, so it's four serial system limbs in parallel. So this is obviously a hybrid system, okay? Not an interconnected hybrid system, just a hybrid system with four serial system limbs in parallel, okay? All right, so how does each one of them move? Well, let's look at this serial limb itself. And first of all, Well, yeah, okay, so let's look at the serial limit itself. So, you have to ask yourself, is there any over-constraint in the serial limb? Okay, first of all. Well, and the answer is no, because no flexure element by itself is over-constrained. It has an order of constraint. So this is an order of constraint of 5, this hinge, and it just rotates there. But it's just stacked in series. So this parallel module is not over-constrained. This parallel module is not over-constrained. Neither is that, neither is that. So no parallel modules are over-constrained. So the only way this system, the top right here, can be over-constrained is through the limbs. Okay, but we'll get back to that later. So there's no over-constraint in each of the serial systems. What about under constraint? Well, think how this guy moves. This guy rotates here. This is the freedom space of this thing, as you recall. There's one here, there's one here, there's one here, and there's one here. And since it's in series, this is the ground, and think of that as the stage, if you're just looking at the serial thing. How does this guy move? Well, obviously 4 degrees of freedom. Are any of these redundant? No, they're all 4 completely different rotations. And they would add up. So you have to ask yourself, well, what's the freedom space of this? What happens when you add this? Like, what happens when you add this plus this? Well, it'd be a parallel plane of parallel red lines, translation arrow there. What's this plus this? A plane of parallel red lines and translation there. Those two translations make a disk, and all those parallel red lines would make a bunch of disks. Okay. So if you look at this. There it is. We're familiar with this freedom space. It's 4DUF type 8. Okay, that would be the freedom space that results. And so since we know there's 4 degrees of freedom in there, and we know each of these, you know, there's 1DUF, 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 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1 equals 4. So we know it's not under constraint. So there'll be no under constraint in any of these limbs. Okay, which means that puts it to bed. The whole system is not under constraint, which is nice, you know, because you've got a CD that's spinning very fast, and you've got this lens that's moving back and forth. So it'd be really bad if there was under constraint, but there's not. None of these bodies are under constraint. If you can control the optic with the actuator and sensor, none of these guys are going to be vibrating doing bad things. Okay, so that's cool. So it's not under constrained. It's not over constrained within any of the elements themselves, but is it over constrained by the limbs? Let's check it out. We still don't know how the thing moves. Okay, so we know each limb moves like this, which means its constraint space is a blue line, an orange wrench, and a pure moment is what it can resist. Well, so that's what the constraint space of each limb is. And now there's 4 that are parallel. So it's basically you think of 4 of these in parallel, you know, moved, you know, like the 4 legs on a table, but they're all doing the force, the moment, and the wrench. And they would all add up to this constraint space. If you add them, think about it. Add 2 blue ones, gets a plane of blue ones with a pure moment going up. Add these 2 blue ones, a plane of blue ones here. Add these 2 blue ones. You know, so you can fill in the box pretty quickly. And if you got a plane of blue ones with a moment going up, and there's moments going this way, you get a disk of moments, and you can just keep going through adding these things and find that it's very easy. You know, and you already have these wrenches of any pitch, and so you can get a box of anything. So you can very quickly, hopefully, add these together, these limb constraint spaces, 4 limb constraint spaces, to get that grand constraint space. Okay, and so first, let's see, we're almost there to find what the freedom space is. You look it up. Here is the, you know, it's the one just outside the parallel pyramid. That one links to this, which is basically every translation that's perpendicular to these blue lines, okay, that lies in a disk, okay? So that's the freedom space of this system, right? So if you go back to this, you think the freedom space would be a disk that's on the plane of this stage of just translations. That's the only way it could move. So apparently all they want the optic mount to do is to move, you know, translate in this direction, the direction the CD is spinning, right? And then translate up and down to focus the laser. So they want to be able to go forward and back on tracks as well as go up and down to scan, to focus things on different parts of the CD. So this freedom space is clearly just 2 pure translations. That's it. One in this direction, one in that direction, right? Okay, but the question is it over constrained? We definitively put to bed this system is not under constrained, which is great. And we know that there's no over constraint in the serial systems, but is the serial system over constrained? So are the limbs over constrained? Well, how many non-redundant constraints should be in this space? Well, 6 minus 2 is 4. And yet, check it out. We had, from this guy, there's two things in there. 6 minus 4 is 2. So what we have is 2 plus 2 plus 2 plus 2 does not equal 4. This is 4 times over constrained. So unfortunately, it is over constrained, and that's going to sacrifice precision. Okay, so the way this guy moves is it translates there and translates there. Like I said, that's the freedom space, or those are the 2 degrees of freedom that makes a disk of freedom space. It's not under constrained, but it's over constrained by 4. So if you were doing, if they, if for whatever reason they didn't like their design, they're like, look, we think we've constrained it right, it's moving right, it's not under constraint everything, but we're not getting the precision we need. Well, you'd say, well, it's probably because you're over constrained. That's usually what happens when you lose your precision. And so say, well, let's make it not as over constrained if you're doing consulting. Well, how would you do that? Well, one thing you could do is you could get rid of one of these and just move that over to the center to make it symmetric still about the directions you're translating so there's no parasitic errors. And it would still add up to this constraint space. Just basically get rid of one of these and move this over, and it would still work, but now it would just be over constrained by 2, and that might work better. Okay? Another thing you could do that would probably work the best is, like I said, just get rid of one of these, move this over to the middle, and then get rid of these and just put a pure wire. So if you just had a blue wire, and then one of these in the middle, it's still symmetric about your two translational planes, right? And so, well, I guess it's not symmetric about that, but it still have pretty darn good parasitic error. It wouldn't have much worse parasitic error than it already has here. Right, but it would have one a lot less mass too, which means it could move faster with less inertia. But three, it would be exactly constrained because you'd have blue plus blue plus blue, orange, and black will make this as well. And now you've got 1 plus 1 plus 2 equals 4. Okay, so that would be maybe one way if they weren't getting, they're probably getting enough precision with this. It's nice and symmetric. It fits in their package here. So it probably works just fine. But if they were having issues, that might be some design suggestions you could make to them that would be very educated and intelligent to eliminate the overconstraint entirely through the limbs. The other thing I see with these CD drives sometimes is they can use the electrical wiring as the constraint flexure. So sometimes, if they need to get, from a battery to a coil, the current flowing through it, they'll actually use the wire that flows to the coil, and then the wire coming back will go this way, and they'll use both the wire as the flexures, as well as an element to get, the current to the coils to drive the system. So you can do some pretty clever things. You combine flexures with electromagnetic elements and stuff. Okay, but with that concludes hybrid system synthesis and elements. You guys should be masters of fact at this point.